morning. I'm going to set this down here. I've got a lot of stuff in my hands here this morning. It's the Bible. That's a good thing to have in your hand. Well, welcome to worship today. My name is Pastor Andrea Paulson. I'm the associate pastor here at First St. Paul's, and it is so good to be here together and worshiping. And Pastor Joel Remmers is back at home celebrating his mother's 80th birthday today. And so I'm sure it has been a lot of fun, and it's been good for him to see family. And so keep them in their prayers as they travel back home today. They have a long drive, and then Joel is taking his daughter back to college tonight when they get back. And so a lot of travel. We have a few announcements this morning. If you do take a look at your announcements, we have a few things. The sermons on the website, due to some unforeseen circumstances, we will not be recording sermons unless, is there a video camera up there this morning? Nope, there's not. Okay. Oh, there is? Oh, good. We're recording sermons again. Yay, God. All right. If you're listening on the radio, yes, I am kind of nuts. We just like to have fun. It's Jesus, really. So the sermons are going to be back on the website. Yay, Jesus. Yay, God. We have a new Facebook check-in. Last month, every check-in we gave to End It Movement, to End Human Trafficking. And starting today, if you check in on Facebook, every check-in will be going to Wellspring Crisis Pregnancy Center to support women in need and provide needed items for babies. And so check in on Facebook and support a great cause. Today there's going to be two separate offerings, an opportunity to give in two separate ways. And so first we'll be doing our regular offering, but then it's also Super Bowl for Caring today. How many of you know what you're eating for the Super Bowl tonight? How many are planning on stuffing your faces tonight? Because why not? Well, today on Super Bowl Sunday, we also want to raise awareness of hunger needs. And so at the end of the service, there will be a soup kettle in the back and a soup kettle up here. And just perhaps think about giving a few dollars or whatever you feel led to give to address hunger concerns in our community. On that note, there's two things I'd have as prayer requests today. It is Super Bowl Sunday. Super Bowl Sunday is the number one day for domestic violence in our country. And so as you watch the Super Bowl today, please be praying for families as they face domestic violence. It's also the number one day for human trafficking in our country, is Super Bowl Sunday. And so in the midst of our joy and our celebrating and the fun and the Falcons or whoever it is that you're cheering for, please do keep those, the least of these, in your prayers. Following this service, there will be a short council meeting for our new council members. We'll meet immediately after this service. On that note, I would invite all of our council members who have just been elected to come forward, please, for our installation. Church leadership here, and we're going to just take a minute to install these faithful servants here at First St. Paul's. And so, congregation, I will give you a cue when it's your turn to say something. St. Paul says, just as each of our bodies has several parts and each part has a separate function, so all of us in union with Christ form one body, and as parts of it, we belong to each other. Our gifts are different according to the grace that has been given to us. And if your gift is prophecy, use it as your faith suggests. If your gift is administration, learn it as your faith suggests. If it is teaching, use it to teach. Let the preachers deliver sermons, the almsgivers give freely, the officials be diligent, and those who do works of mercy do so cheerfully. And now, leadership and council members, I have a couple questions for you this morning. Will each of you assume the office to which you have been elected, and will you endeavor to discharge its duties fully to the glory of Christ our Lord and in service to his holy church for St. Paul's? If so, say, I will, and I ask God to help me. And you people of God, the body First St. Paul's, will you support and pray for each of these council members as they serve in this way? If so, say, we will.
We will.
And so the office of church council member is committed to each of you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us pray together and join in prayer. Gracious Father, you call your people to service, and you give them varied tasks in the world and in your church. We pray that you grant each of them grace and strength, that they would serve you faithfully to the glory of your name through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. The God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, the great shepherd of the sheep, by the blood of the eternal covenant, we pray that he would equip each of you with everything good, that you may do his will, working in you that which is pleasing in his sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom the glory be forever and ever. Amen. As we send you back to your seats, I would like to just take a moment to thank you all for serving the church faithfully and with wisdom and discernment. And I want to encourage you to continue to seek Christ, seek his will for our church. And we are so blessed that each of you have chosen to serve and have stepped up to serve. And so please know that I am praying for you, Joel is praying for you, and the church united is praying for you. Thank you so much for serving with these gifts. Church, would you join together and welcome and accept our council leaders? Thank you so much. And as they go back to their seats, I invite everybody to rise and join together to welcome one another. The peace of Christ be with you always. I invite you to move about the room and welcome others to worship today. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from our sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit, that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
And now let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another. Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all of our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. And as we receive that forgiveness, we will open this morning with number 779, Amazing Grace.
Amen.
is on page 2 of the bulletin. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Savior and Lord. Amen. Please be seated.
This morning can be found in Isaiah chapter 58, verses 1 through 9a, and can be found in your pew Bibles on pages 600 and 601. Shout out, do not hold back. Lift up your voice like a trumpet. Announce to my people their rebellion, to the house of Jacob their sins. Yet day after day they seek me and delight to know my ways. as if they were a nation that practiced righteousness and did not forsake the ordinance of their God. They ask of me righteous judgments. They delight to draw near to God. Why do we fast, but you do not see? Why humble yourselves, but you do not notice? Look, you serve your own interest on your fast day and oppress all your workers. Look, you fast only to quarrel and to fight and to strike with a wicked fist. Such fasting as you do today will not make your voice heard on high. Is such a fast that I choose a day to humble myself? Is it to bow down the head like a bulrush and to lie in sackcloth and ashes? Will you call this a fast, a day acceptable to the Lord? Is not this the fast that I choose, to loose the bonds of injustice, to undo the thongs of the yoke, to let the oppressed go free and to break every yoke? Is it not to share your bread with the hungry and bring the homeless poor into your house? When you see the naked, to cover them and not to hide yourself from your own kin. Then your light shall break forth like the dawn, and your healing shall spring up quickly. Your vindicator shall go before you. The glory of the Lord shall be your rear guard. Then you shall call, and the Lord will answer. You shall cry for help, and he will say, "Here I am." The second reading is found in 1 Corinthians chapter 2, verses 1 through 12, and is on page 927 in the Pew Bible. When I came to you, brothers and sisters, I did not come proclaiming the mystery of God to you in lofty words or wisdom, for I decided to know nothing among you except Jesus Christ and him crucified. And I came to you in weakness and in fear and in much trembling. My speech and my proclamation were not with plausible words of wisdom, but with a demonstration of the Spirit and of power, so that your faith might rest not on human wisdom, but on the power of God. Yet among the mature we do speak wisdom, though it is not a wisdom of this age or of the rulers of this age, who are doomed to perish. But we speak God's wisdom, secret and hidden, which God decreed before the ages for our glory. None of the rulers of this age understood this, for if they had, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. But as it is written, what no eye has seen, nor ear heard, nor the human heart conceived, what God has prepared for those who love him. These things God has revealed to us through the Spirit, for the Spirit searches everything, even the depths of God. For what human being knows what is truly human, except the human spirit that is within? So also no one comprehends what is truly God's, except the Spirit of God. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, but the Spirit that is from God, so that we may understand the gifts bestowed on us by God. Here end the readings. Please stand for the gospel.
Lighting a lamp puts it under the bushel basket,
but on the lampstand, and it gives light to all in the house. In the same way, let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. Do not think that I have come to abolish the law or the prophets. I have not come to abolish, but to fulfill. For truly I tell you, until heaven and earth pass away, not one letter, not one stroke of a letter will pass from the law until it all is accomplished. Therefore, whoever breaks one of the least of these commandments and teaches the others to do the same will be called least in the kingdom of God. But whoever does them and teaches them will be called great in the kingdom of heaven. For I tell you, unless your righteousness exceeds that of the scribes and Pharisees, you will never enter the kingdom of heaven. This is the gospel of our Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Our hymn is number 661, I Love to Tell the Story. Here at First St. Paul's, you know that I've served in youth ministry for many years. If you're visiting today, you just learned that I've served for youth ministry in many years. And when I was serving youth ministry at Atonement, the church I came from in Fargo, we had a movie that we used quite, you know, every couple years with the youth. And it was one of those movies that really never went out of date. And the movie was called To Save a Life. And in this film, there's a young man named Jake who is unchurched. And through a series of circumstances, devastating circumstances, he is invited by a youth pastor to attend church. And so Jake gets the courage and goes to this group meeting. And the pastor is preaching a message. And the question that he poses to his youth ministry, his youth group, is why do we so often do exactly the opposite of what the Bible teaches? And so as youth pastors, youth ministers tend to do, they say, take a minute and think about that. And immediately, as tends to happen, they start checking their phones, talking to their friends, doing anything but reflecting on what the pastor has shared. And just in case you adults think you're better, we all do this. As soon as we're said, think about this for a second, the phones come out, the conversations start. And so this is why it's applicable for everybody. So Jake is this young man, and he's sitting over against a wall, and he sees this, and he stands up frustrated. And he asks this question of them and the group, the pastor, what's the point of all of this if you're not going to let it change you? I thought about this movie for this week and this passage because I think about all I read in Scripture and all I hear and all I've learned about this old, old story. And I think about passages about caring for the least and humility and seeking justice and passages to be aliens of this world, and so many others. And I think of this call to be salt and light. And for myself, the question that kept coming to mind, what is the point of all of this, Andrea, if you're not gonna let it change you? And church, what is the point of all of this? The hymns we sing, the stained glass that we admire, the choir, the organist, all that we do, what is the point of all of this if we're not going to let it change us? What is the point of all of this if we are not going to glorify God? Let's pray. Lord, you have called us to be salt and light, to do good deeds for your glory. And yet we are so often resistant to hearing the call to be salt and light, so that others may see you and glorify you. Today, God, I pray that the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart would be pleasing in your sight, O Lord, my God, my rock, and my redeemer. Amen. This passage today that we are studying is a part of a larger swath of Scripture. It's called, most of us know this, the old, old story called the Sermon on the Mount. And perhaps a better term for it that would more help us better understand what's happening here is the teaching on discipleship. And here what's happening from Matthew 5 through Matthew 7, 28 is Jesus, the Messiah, is calling his disciples to righteousness. And throughout this teaching on discipleship, he is revealing what it means and what it looks like to live according to God's will. And so righteousness, according to Jesus in this swath of Scripture, is doing God's will. And as you read through these two and a half passages, what you'll find are a couple themes that come up. First is, what sets us as disciples apart? Jesus teaches about what is going to set them apart. He talks a lot about fulfilling the law. What does it mean to fulfill the law? What will fulfill the law? He teaches about piety, righteousness, both true and false. And then he teaches about trusting God over material security. And then finally, in the last verse of this, verse 27, 28, sorry, my Bible pages are sticking together this morning. In verses 27, or 28 and 29, We read, "Now when Jesus had finished saying these things, the crowds were astounded at his teaching, for he taught them as one having authority and not as their scribes." Throughout this passage of scripture, Jesus isn't teaching the gospel. He's not teaching the good news or why he came. He is telling those who have already responded what they are being called to. The disciples are called to a radical new lifestyle, a Christian counterculture, if you will. And his teaching in authority, with authority, is for those who need to learn what life in the kingdom of heaven is really about if they're going to tell others. It is a guide also for those who have already committed to the kingdom of heaven. And so within this teaching, through it all, we have this one passage on salt and light. You are the salt of the earth. Be different. You are the light of the world. Be seen as different. So let's talk about this be different for a second. Jesus first says to the disciples that you are the salt of the earth. The first call for the disciples and for us is to be different. So what is this about salt? At the time, salt was essential to the life of everybody. The most significant uses of salt at the time were flavoring. We still like salt. Yay, potato chips. But also for preservation. Preserving food so that it would not spoil. Just like salt was essential, the disciples were no less essential to the well-being of human life. And so for the disciples then and for us today, flavoring and preservation apply. The disciples are to provide flavor to the world. And what does that flavor look like? Wisdom and discernment and continually pointing to God's will. The disciples are also called to preserve by helping to prevent spoiling and corruption. And how do they do this? By pointing to God's will. You are the salt of the earth. You are the light of this world. Be seen as different. You see, light penetrates darkness and cannot and should not be hidden. Where there is light, no matter how small, people can find their way. A small amount of light can make everything clear. Just the other night at confirmation, we turned all the lights off and had the eighth graders sit in the dark. And it was amazing how one small light from a flashlight could help make things clear. No matter which way you cut it, where there is darkness, people stumble and get lost. This is why we use night lights in our home. This is why we usually leave a light on for our kids when they're little, or even as we become adults, a small light so that if we need to get up in the night, we can make our way. Disciples are called to provide for others the light that Jesus gives. Jesus is the light of the world. That's not our calls, it's his. In him there is no darkness, none at all. And the disciples, though, will be commissioned to share this light. The world needs light. There's no question about that. And it is through the disciples that it will be made visible. Be different. You are the salt of the earth. Be seen. Be seen as different. But the thing about this call to be the light of the world is that it's not just individual. We are each called to shine our light individually. But it is also use-alls. Greek term. My Greek prof again. This is not a Greek term. This is a Gertner term. Use. Because one light can shine, but many lights shine brighter. A city built on a hill cannot be hidden. There is a combined impact of many lights. And when the disciple community shines together, it impacts the surrounding darkness in a whole new way. Just think about when you come into Hastings late at night and you see the lights of the plants shining. You can't miss it. It's not just one light, it's many. They glow for miles. Jesus tells his disciples to shine individually, but to shine as a disciple community. be salt and be seen as light. But what's the point of all this if you're not going to let it change you? The thing is that Jesus follows each of these instructions with a contrast. You are the salt of the earth, but the thing is that if salt is no longer salty, then what's the point of salt? If salt has lost its taste, it cannot be restored as salty. Jesus isn't teaching chemistry here. It is simply ludicrous to try to salt something that should be the source of salt. When salt loses its saltiness, it loses its entire reason for being. It is completely useless, thrown aside. The point of all of this? If disciples have lost their distinctiveness in the world, they have nothing to contribute. That's pretty harsh, but that's what Jesus is saying. If you cease being salt, you have nothing different to contribute here. And so the lesson for us is that losing our saltiness means that we're losing our identity that sets us apart from the foolishness of the world. Last week we talked about the foolishness that we proclaim. If we lose our identity in Christ, we are not set apart with that. Losing our saltiness for us today means being corrupted by the world because we're not following what Jesus teaches. Losing saltiness means becoming loyal to another Lord, another idol, and easily corrupted by it. What's the point of all this talk about salt if you're not going to let it change you? Jesus does the same thing with the teaching on light. You are the light of the world, but no one, after lighting a lamp, puts it under a basket. And again, Jesus isn't talking about why fire goes out. He's not teaching physics. This isn't about how fire works. Instead, he's talking about how crazily absurd it is to hide a lamp when the point of a light is to be seen. And so the lesson for us is that the life of us as disciples, a follower of Christ, includes a job description. And this is not private personal holiness. It is good to have a relationship with Christ and to know him, but keeping it to ourselves is the same as grabbing a basket and covering ourselves. The point of being saved by grace through faith is to let it be seen and let it shine. It means to let it shine individually, but also as one body of Christ united under the cross. And so what is the point of all this talk about light if you're not going to let it change you? Often when we teach these passages and read these passages, we talk a lot about salt and light, and that's good. But there's something else here. Here's a third part, and it's the only command. We have the lesson on salt. We have the lesson on light. Be different. Be seen as different. But Jesus' emphasis and his command for action is in verse 16. In the same way, let your light shine before others so that they may see your good works and give glory to your Father in heaven. The point of all of this, salt and light in us, is to give God glory. We don't need to do a thing to earn heaven. We are saved by grace through faith, and that is not of our own doing, so that nobody can boast. Let us be clear about that. But if we talk about salt and light but ignore the responsive action, we have given over to cheap grace. The message of the cross that we talked about last week of guilt and justice and love and victory over sin is not just for improving ourselves and self-help. The essence of being salt of the earth and light of the world is what we do as a result of what was done for us. The goal of witness, both disciples and our own, is not so that people will imitate us or applaud that we're great. It's so that through our lives they'll want to come and see. It is so that people will recognize the source. It is so that all of our salty shining is to glorify God. And so what is the point of salt and light if we're not going to let it shine? I started thinking about what this means for us individually and myself and as a church. And as we think about how to apply it this week, the first thing I have for Monday is the question for each of us and all of us together is, what is the point of all this if we're not going to let it change us? I think there comes a point in our lives when we really need to look at our motives for being part of the body of Christ. Now, to be clear, I know from experience that there are seasons of life when all we can do is just step through the door. There are seasons in our faith life that just to make it to church is a challenge. And if you are here today or listening to this today, and you are struggling and hurt, please know that you are welcome here in your sadness and your brokenness and your hurt. And please know that the body of Christ desires to be a balm for your spirit. Allow yourself time. The church is for you, and Christ is for you. I've been there, and it is painful. But you are not alone, and Christ is for you. But I also know that there have been times in my faith life that participation in the body of Christ has been about me and not about him. It has been self-seeking, self-adulating, and sometimes self-depreciating. I do youth ministry. And for some of us, our whole lives have been spent going through the motions, sometimes unapologetically. And so our first challenge for us is to think about, what is the point of all of this if we're not going to let it change us? A second thing to consider, I think, is, have I lost my saltiness? We are called to be different. And so where in life have we given up ground to a false gospel? Where have you given ground to truth that isn't truth? Where in life have you lost or surrendered your identity as first a child of God? Where do you need to rediscover and reclaim that you are sealed by the Holy Spirit and marked by the cross of Christ forever? Have I lost my saltiness? Another thing to consider is, where or how am I hiding my light? Where do I find the bushel and easily put it over top of me? We all have areas that are harder to shine. Some of us, that is in our extended families. Some of that is in our workplaces. If you work in a public school or public sector, it's very difficult to be bold and to shine, and I understand that. We all have areas that it is harder to let the light of Christ be seen. But sometimes we intentionally grab that bushel. We intentionally cover the light. And so for each of us, we must reflect on why. Why do I hide what is meant to be seen? Ask God for strength to share who you are in Christ. And the final thing for us today is to remember that the lone imperative, the lone command in this is to shine. What's the point of all of this? The point is to glorify God. And so the question for us individually and us as a church is, what is God's call to action for me? And what is God's call for action for this church? It's interesting that we're doing this on a day we install new leaders. What is our call for action? We are salt. We are light. We are both for a purpose. We are both on purpose. And Lord, help us shine for your glory. Amen. I invite you to rise to sing our next hymn, number 677. Thank you.
join me as we confess together the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. At this time, we will have our prayers of the day. I will end each petition with, Lord, hear our prayer. Please respond, your mercy is great. Lord God, you receive the prayers of all who call upon you. By your Spirit, show us what we ought to do and give us grace and power. And let us pray for God's mercy, his grace, his peace, and his healing. Eternal God, you are a God of community. Strengthen the bonds of your church across the denominations. Solidify the ecumenical partnerships as they work to shine the light of Jesus in a world that's in need of hope and healing. So hear us, O God. Ignite the nations with the flame of your Spirit. Bring wisdom to those who seek to make your name great. Empower and encourage the church leaders as they boldly proclaim the gospel to every tribe, every tongue, and every nation. Hear us, O God. Fill those who form the faith of others with insight and energy. Remind them of the powerful message they proclaim. Multiply the fruit of their labor. Raise up disciples that are eager to learn your living word and are committed to following wherever you call. Hear us, O God. Pour out your gifts on all people. Inspire the members of this faith community to step out boldly and to use their gifts and talents to make your name great. And we lift up before you today those who are called to lead in this place. And so we think this morning of Seth Anderson, Greg Otten, Don Conyers, Aaron Deeker, Brent Grable, Larry Herrenstein, Barbara Holland, John Holland, Don Jansen, Lisa Kautz, Trent Kelly, Jeff Morris, Chad Power, Brandon Savage, and Deanna Tout, who are installed as congregational council members today. May they seek your kingdom vision in all that they do. So hear us, O God. Compassionate God, comfort the afflicted, heal the brokenhearted, the newly diagnosed, and all who suffer. And this morning, we think especially of Eunice Beanoff, Mary Geisler, Margaret Anderson, and Christine Schaefer. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We thank you for all the saints who have boldly shone in the light of Christ. Compel us to shine boldly and witness to your abundant grace each day. So hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
And so, dear Lord, receive these prayers in the name of Christ, the light of the world, who is one with you and the Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. At this time, we will receive our gifts and offerings. Please be seated. Also remember the special offering this morning.
Savior and Lord. Amen. Open to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of the angels and with the church on earth and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. And he said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, shed for you and for all people, for the forgiveness of sins. Every time you drink of it, do so in remembrance of me. For as often as we eat of this bread and drink from this cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." I have good news for you today, my friends. Christ has died, and Christ has risen, and Christ will come again. The table is prepared, and ushers will show you forward.
Thank you.
As we take this meal, we pray the way that he taught us, because I forgot to do that. And so let's pray the way that our Lord and Savior Jesus taught us. Our Father,
who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Lord God, you have refreshed us with your heavenly meal. You are our dearest treasure, and so we pray now that you would go with us today and in every day to come, that we would tell the story of your never-ending love and sing your praises both now and forever. Amen. And now may the Lord bless you and keep you. May he make his face to shine upon you. Would he look upon you with favor and give you his peace. Amen. Our closing hymn is number 551, The Spirit Sends Us Forth to Serve.
Thanks be to God.